Good morning. Welcome to worship at Asbury for those who are present and those who are present with us via the internet. Please rise and join me in the call to worship as printed in our bulletin. God has come among us. Let us rejoice. Praise the Lord, all creation. For God's name alone is exalted. God's glory is above heaven and earth. First reading this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 63, verses 7 through 9. I will recount the gracious deeds of the Lord, the praiseworthy acts of the Lord, because of all that the Lord has done for us, and the great favor to the house of Israel that he has shown them according to his mercy, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he said, surely they are my people, children who will not deal falsely. And he became their savior. In all their distress, it was no messenger or angel, but his presence that saved them. In his love and in his pity, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old.
Thank you. Since Monday is Martin Luther King Jr. Day, we will be performing the hymnal Lift Every Voice and Sing, a piece that represents his fight for rights and the word that God has given him.
The second reading this morning is taken from the book of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 13 through 23. Now after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there till I tell you. For Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night, and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." When Herod saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, he was infuriated. He sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had heard and had learned from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken by the prophet Jeremiah. A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing and loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled because they are no more. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel. For those who were seeking the child's life are dead." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was ruling over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And after being warned in a dream, he went away to the district of Galilee. There he made his home in a town called Nazareth, so that what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. "He will be called a Nazarene." This is the word of the Lord.
De tierra lejana venimos a verte, nos sirve de guía la estrella de oriente. Oh brillante estrella que anuncias la aurora, no nos falte nunca tu luz bienhechora. Gloria en las alturas al Hijo de Dios, gloria en las alturas y en la tierra amor.
Love me is good song and
In today's gospel lesson, there are two responses to the baby Jesus: fear and faithfulness. Fear is embodied in the person of Herod. In Herod, we see a troubled, jealous king, a deceptive king, a deceived king, a plotting, threatening king, a raging, vengeful king, and a dead king. So Herod, the troubled, frightened, jealous king, he was frightened at the question asked by the wise men, "Where is the king born of the Jews to be born?" And all Jerusalem was fearful with him, perhaps for a different reason than Herod's. For Herod, his power was being challenged. We call the Magi wise men, but I wonder how wise it was to ask the sitting king the address of the new king. And as we know, Herod, the deceptive king, says, "Once you have found him, come back and let me know so I may join you at once in worshiping him." Thankfully, God intervened in a dream, and the wise men went home by a different road, and thus we have Herod, the deceptive king, becomes Herod, the deceived king. And he didn't like being deceived, and so he becomes plotting and threatening, nothing new for him. Herod thought nothing of having his own family members killed, two of them being his own sons, because he was threatened by them. So this ruthless Herod becomes the raging, vengeful king who kills all the children in Bethlehem, all the baby boys 2 years old and under. Artist Fra Angelico depicts Herod, who sent people to do his dirty work. In the painting, Herod is looking down while the soldiers do his dirty work of massacring Bethlehem's baby boys. Herod was so full of himself that he didn't care if others died in his quest to feed his own ego. And the account ends with Herod, the dead king, of course, making it safe for Joseph to sort of return with Mary and Jesus. Herod dies in this passage, but yet something for us to consider is that Herod is personified and lives on in forces, maybe forces in us, that put ourselves above God and put ourselves above the well-being of other people. Throughout this passage, we see God's redemptive activity at work, not only in history, but also in eternity. La Vierge has this famous painting of Mary, Jesus, and the Holy Innocents portraying the victims of Herod's massacre in Bethlehem. If you see a parallel between this Joseph's dreams and another Joseph who we know from the Old Testament and his dreams, I think the writer of Matthew would have been very, very happy to say, yes, they get it. So God speaks in dreams. And if you recognize the rescue of Jesus from Herod and its parallel to the rescue of Moses from Pharaoh, remember the story of Pharaoh wanting the Hebrew midwives to snuff out the lives of all the baby Hebrew boys that are born? Strong parallel with Herod. And Moses' mother hides Moses in the reeds in the river to be found by the princess who takes the baby and says to her father, the Pharaoh, can we keep him? But how am I going to nurse him? I don't have children of my own. I can't nurse a child. And out pops Moses' sister Miriam to say, how about if I get one of the Hebrew wet nurses for you? And the princess is delighted. So irony of ironies, the Pharaoh who seeks to snuff out Moses is the Pharaoh who hosts Moses and his mother during Moses' growing up years until he becomes the liberator of his people from Pharaoh. And so Joseph is told in a dream, just like Moses was told from the burning bush, get up, get up. There's something you need to do. You need to go to Egypt. And you wonder if the gifts that the Magi brought, apart from their symbolic meaning, gold for royalty, frankincense for being worshipped, myrrh for burial, you wonder if the value of these gifts helped sustain Joseph, Mary, and Jesus on their trip to Egypt. But imagine Egypt. It's not a place you want to go. It's a place where you want to get out of. Our ancestors came out of Egypt because they were enslaved there. Why would anyone want to go back? Well, because God instructs you to go back. And so Joseph did. And he took Mary and he took Jesus. It's amazing how Herod's antics pale in comparison with God's much larger purposes. And Herod, for all of his threats and raging, is ultimately powerless over the one true king, the one born king of the Jews. It's fascinating to see the fall of a tyrant to a baby king who was born to liberate us from tyrants. And so Joseph's response was faithfulness, as opposed to Herod's response being fear. In this portrait from El Greco, Joseph is not shown to be an old, soon-to-die man. He's shown as a young, robust, tall, strong man capable of assisting on the sojourn to Egypt and back. Migration is not a new phenomenon, not for animals, not for people, and certainly not in the Bible. Much of the biblical story and God's greater purposes involve migration. We only need to think of hunter-gatherers or people who migrated south in the winter, then back north in the summer, or shepherds who graze their sheep in one area in the winter, another area in the summer, or maybe our own ancestors who migrated here from somewhere. It's our history. It's here to stay, whether we're in search of food or water or safety or work or to join our families, or whether it's a seasonal migration, think snowbirds this time of year who winter in Florida, or think of the folks who stayed in our church building last night and the night before, some of the homeless population of York who are temporarily migrating, no permanent place. Think of people who are forced to flee because of changing climate. Maybe their land can't produce food anymore, or the water is evaporating and not producing fish anymore. Or think of, as we celebrate Martin Luther King Jr. Day officially tomorrow, think of people who were forced into migration, whether the African slaves who were brought here or Native Americans who were forced to relocate in the Trail of Tears. And so this is the story of Jesus, who the book of Hebrews says can relate to us in every way, because Jesus has experienced everything that we humans have experienced, and yet was the sinless one, yet was our Redeemer. When Joseph and Mary and Jesus return, they don't go back to Bethlehem of Judea. They go to Galilee in Nazareth. That's why we hear Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus the Galilean. And he wasn't of Nazareth because that's where Joseph and Mary were living before he was born, but Jesus of Nazareth because that's where they went to avoid the threats of Herod's son, Archelaus, who was now on the throne in Bethlehem and in Judea. Iconographer Kelly Lattimore does her artwork in order to help worshipers better understand who is God, who are we as Jesus' followers, and who are our neighbors? In this particular depiction of Joseph, Mary, and Jesus, she portrays them as migrants from south of the U.S. border, which makes me think of the current band of migrants from Honduras who are on their way north, stuck at the Guatemala border. Reporters were interviewing them. Why are you part of this caravan? They said, there's absolutely no work. Having lived in Honduras twice, it was very evident to me that it is the second poorest country in the Western Hemisphere. Truly, even if you could find work, you could scarcely say it was sustaining work. And so the story of Joseph and Mary and Jesus fleeing to Egypt and returning should help us to become more empathetic to people who migrate out of need. The scriptures today encourage us in so many ways. Let your light shine. There are two kinds of light. Light that illumines and light that blinds. There's the gentle illumining light, like candlelight, like the light by which we read, that helps us to see in a helpful way. And then there's the glare of the oncoming headlights that blinds you. So let your light shine means we don't have to put out someone else's light in order for our light to shine. In fact, by allowing and helping someone else's light to glow, our light burns even more brightly. As we think of the children who were killed by Herod, I can't help but think of the children, the farmers, the innocent civilians who have been killed by drone strikes in quest of taking out one person. Hopefully, our readings today will encourage us to not acquiesce, not bow down, not kowtow to the kind of leadership that snuffs out the glory of God in Jesus Christ, the kind of leadership that snuffs out peace and goodwill toward all people, not just some people. This is an invitation for us to be faithful like Joseph, not fearful like Herod. To be alert and attentive to opportunities to be helpful in Jesus' name. To be alert for messages, be they dreams. Be they angelic messages, that is, people like you and me who speak for God from time to time. My prayer is that these readings, these stories today, will give us the strength to get up when God says get up, to go when God says go, especially if the message from God challenges our thinking, especially if the message from God challenges our comfort level. May God bless all people. May God's goodwill be spread to all people. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Please be seated. Those of you here in person came into a very different looking worship space. Many thanks to the few of you who took down, climbed ladders, put away, stored securely till next year our Christmas decorations. We want to celebrate with Beppi Baker, her 90th birthday. I caught her just as she was taking a drink of water. Hope you didn't choke on that, Beppi. But happy birthday. We also want to We also want to celebrate with Mike Freet his recent report from his oncologist that his cancer is in remission. Also, we continue to pray for Sharon Roger, who continues to recover at home from her recent lengthy hospitalization. Also, I would like to acknowledge hymn writer Carolyn Winfrey Gillette, who wrote about 15 or so years ago the hymn we just sang. Carolyn is a pastor, associate pastor at the Owego, New York Presbyterian Church. And so I'm grateful for Carolyn's ministry of hymn writing. We want to lift up Vicki Hemmaker, whose mother died yesterday. Also, we want to lift up the work of the church, particularly as we look toward Martin Luther King Jr. Day tomorrow. What do we still need to do to stand up and be the church as we hear news of hostages taken, like in the synagogue yesterday in Texas, or as we hear of the work of the Proud Boys in their discrimination campaign? We also want to lift up one of our choir members, Nellie Christ, who is not singing with us today because there was a smoke alarm in their apartment and smoke damage, and so we pray that that's not too much of an undertaking to get things straightened back around again, particularly with this cold weather when it makes it hard to air it out. So we pray for Nellie and for her roommates as they recover from that. You may have noticed as you came in this morning on the information desk that your giving statements for 2021 are available. We'll make them available this week and next for you to take personally. Those that are not taken will be then mailed out. Shall we be in prayer? Infinite God, God beyond time, God of our time and history, God who has worked your redeeming work throughout holy history, God who is every bit as present with us now as with our biblical forebears, God of goodness and light, nurturing God, you have given us everything that we need to live meaningful lives that honor you and enhance the lives of others. Hear our praises and voices, young and old, high and low, weak and strong. Like Herod before us, our fears sometimes cause us to feel threatened when our way of thinking is challenged. So often we live out our pride and stubbornness and fail to turn to you in our time of need. Forgive us, God. Thank you for governing the times and the seasons. Thank you for our families that have known the cycles of times and seasons, the cycles of change as generations rise and pass away. We rejoice in the babies, the children and grandchildren in our lives, and in the long life which allows many of us to see them grow up to adulthood. Remembering the exile of the Holy Family and Herod's slaughter of the children, light a path for us by which we may be able to see, to walk in faithfulness. Give us sight and insight to set aside our fragile egos and to flee into your loving and protective arms until our time of silence comes. Our lives are in your hands. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, King of Kings and Prince of Peace. Amen. As we prepare to celebrate what God does with our gifts, I want to talk a little bit about Code Blue. Last night, there were six people that stayed overnight in Asbury's church building. The previous night, seven. Unfortunately, tonight, it will not be open. This would be the night where, in a perfect world, it would be open. But we can't open due to lack of staffing. And the reason there isn't staffing is because there aren't enough applicants for the professional staff needed to oversee the Code Blue shelter. We can't simply volunteer without professional staff because of what is involved in us hosting the shelter. So please pray that God will guide people to apply for these positions. The past two nights, Ryan Suppler was here as the professional staff person. Ryan has a full-time job, but has agreed to stay on doing this in addition to his full-time job because Ryan knows the need. And so if you know of anybody, please direct them to the Children's Aid Society to their employment opportunities page. Also today is the Human Relations Day offering of our church. It coincides with Martin Luther King Jr. Sunday. The purpose of Human Relations Day is social justice education, leadership training and development, and public policy advocacy. If you would like to participate in this work of connecting our works, our ministries of mercy with our ministries of justice, checks can be made out to Asbury United Methodist Church with the memo marked Human Relations Day, and our offerings will get to the appropriate place. Will you please stand? Light and promise, we bring our gifts to further your work in a dark world. May they bring your light to those overwhelmed by fear, darkness, pain, and loneliness. Accept our gifts of money and time, the gift of our very selves. Let them shine for all to see and be brought into the realm of your love and forgiveness. Amen. We are called to love. love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to love humbly with God. Go forth to love and serve God in all that you do. In God's strength, comfort the afflicted, stand with those who weep, and defend the oppressed. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with you now and always, and unto ages of ages. Amen.